voice out of heaven, saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things have passed away. And when John was concluding his writings, he said, Even so come, Lord Jesus. Greg experienced a lot of suffering down here, but he's in a land now where there's no more suffering, no more pain, no more death and dying. All of that is done away with. May God bless us as we've heard his word, and may we allow this word to continue to abide in our hearts and help us in the days to come.
Study at our church with our pastor and having Bible study. sung to us and always had some little song or something to say that would catch your heart, your mind, your thought. And later on, as he would sing to us, Mama asked me one night, says, "Oh, do you mind if I say a little something?" I says, "Not at all." You know, the word says, from the abundance of the heart, so does the mouth speak. So I said, if he's got a song in his heart, he's got a word in his heart. Amen? Good words. So I told him, surely he could. Well, naturally, he spoke to us a number of times and always gave us a good word, and I enjoyed sharing my pulpit with him. He didn't claim to be a preacher. He claimed to be such a great minister, but he had a word and a song in his heart. One thing about Greg, if I was down, he could pick me up. A lot of folks says, "But you're the preacher." I used to have a lady at our church, and she's a wonderful lady. I always expected Pastor Frank at Vacation Bible School. She'd always come to me at things and go right, and she said, "But you're the preacher." I said, "Yes, and I'm a human being also." Yeah. You know, and as I was saying, if I was down, Greg could pick me up. If Greg was down, I could pick him up. I believe all of us, as I speak to you today, I believe we all have times and seasons in life that God places and positions people in our life to help, to share, to uphold, to strengthen, to give to one another, not so much as something out of your pocket or wrapped package or gift, but something you can hold on to in your thoughts, in your heart, in your daily living, something we can relate to, such as pictures and stuff. I remember bringing Gabby to church when she was a little bit of thing, and I saw her after last evening. I said, "My star, she's growing all up." You know, and that lets me know that I've had a few more birthdays myself. But, you know, I think about, I have a book at home that I got about a good Sunday in it when I was preparing. And the title of the book, a friend of mine down in Richmond, it's called Furlong, wrote it before his passing. And the title of it was The Issues of Life. Certainly Greg had many issues. Many of us had many issues in life. Greg had bad times, but like he had probably hadn't been dealt such a good hand. That didn't mean Greg was not a good man. It means he's such as we are, with the flesh, God said. This word again that we stand on today and find strength in and gain strength from today is what kept Greg in his walk of affliction, his walk of trial, of tribulation, of hardship. He found strength in it. It tells me that in what I knew of Greg, or what I had known of Greg, that it relates back to his early city I mentioned long ago. It was telling me that he even had his grandmother's Bible, I believe, was one of his Bibles that he had looked at and studied. And I think about, we get out of something what we put in it. If we put the Word of God in our hearts, if we allow our God, allow Christ to come into our lives as Savior, we can make a mark in life, not because of ourselves, but because of the God that is within us. That's what Greg done. He made a mark and an impression on many lives and many things for us to remember about him because of the God that was in him. It was not that he walked around and said, I've been dealt a bad hand, I've had this, I've had that. It's not so. We was laughing last evening or yesterday afternoon about Greg wanted some chocolate ice cream. Drank a syrup out of that bottle, like lemonade from a certain place. find him to be compassionate. Show compassion for someone, or that's something that will say he loved his. We go a little bit further. And the love of Christ in his heart did not pass. When Greg passed, it left his life into a new life. It brought to my mind, and Pastor Frank told me he didn't mind if I used a couple of scriptures, and I hope I don't steal his message for today. But I thought about Paul the Apostle when he was sitting in prison and preaching to be offered up. He was writing to Timothy, calling Timothy his son, which Timothy was not, but he had fathered him in the Lord. And he made a statement. He says, "I am now ready to be offered. I will leave sure less reason. Ready to be beaten to you. You will have a chocolate ice cream and a little syrup, maybe, or whatever, you know." He says, "But I am now ready to be offered up." Paul speaking. The term "ready" he mentions that the Holy Spirit had already impressed on Paul's heart. His time of departure was at hand. Greg knew his time of departure was at hand. He goes on to say, he says, "The time of my departure is at hand." He goes on to say, he says, "I have fought a good fight." The apostle speaking here. He says, "I have finished my course." I believe in Greg's life with his affliction. Absolutely. He fought a good fight. You know, I've said this, and I hope you don't mind me using myself. I've made this statement before recently. I used to feel good all the time and have a bad day every now and then. And I feel bad most of the time and have a good day every now and then. That's a little humor, but it seems that way sometimes. But he goes on to say, he says, "I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course." In other words, I've been faithful. I have kept the faith. Makes first reason like this. He says, "Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, a victor's crown, praise God." If you could ask Greg today, "Greg, would you like to go back?" You could drag him back there in here in this mess. He would want to come back. He wants you to be where he's at, praise God. Presence of Almighty God. He said, "That's laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge." I got to relate back to something in that Psalm 66, verse 8, I just thought about a while ago when the song was playing about the storm and the tears. The word says he bottles up our tears. He says he knows all the wonders. Everything that happens in our lives. Greg McFarland never had a tear that failed to be drawn because God Almighty bottled him up for his time and season with him, not only in this life but in eternity to come. He says, "Henceforth there's laid up for me a crown of righteousness, a victor's triumph, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, not to me only, all them also who love his appearance."
family, conversationalist, family and faith are words that I want to use for a few moments as witness, so we can look into the life of a man we've all learned to admire and appreciate over the years. We pause and celebrate the contributions that he made to family, friends, and community. Greg has loved music all his life, and his music and that of others have brought him much satisfaction and pleasure over the years. Music has introduced him to people that he would have never known. It has allowed him to travel around the country and world. By just knowing and playing the music, it's introduced him to cultures and ways of thinking, and it has soothed his heart, mind, and soul. Greg can play the guitar and drums as well as anyone I've ever known. He was a musician par excellence. Greg was very friendly and outgoing. I don't think he ever met a stranger. His friendships go back to childhood. If you look at the funeral home website on the condolences, you'll see some people that have expressed their love for Greg and their relationship with him that go back years and years and years. School days, employment experiences, neighborhoods, people he met along the journey of life itself, all these people, when they met Greg, they remembered Greg. Many of those are still active and current. Some are the type that he may have not spoken to the person for years, and all of a sudden, they meet up, and they start a conversation like they've just spoken to each other yesterday. Greg was a loyal friend and a keeper of confidence. He would defend you. He was there for you, and he never overwhelmed you. He was a true friend. He's what I call a Proverbs 18:24 friend. A man that hath friends will show himself friendly. And there is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. Greg was the type of guy that would speak first. He would stick his hand out and shake yours first. He would embrace you first. And he would say something kind and nice and encouraging to you first. He was that kind of friend. There's one thing that he was very good at, and that was conversation. Now, this word carries with things like chat, talk, discussion, and dialogue, and name a few. But any one of those you use fits Greg. He could talk about the many things he knew of and other things he knew nothing about. He could talk to you about things he didn't know of. You would think he knew all about it. He could strike up a conversation with about anyone. It didn't matter what station in life they were from. Greg enjoyed biblical conversations and discussions of Scripture, current events that they relate to the Bible. His ability to talk about Scripture matters only grew during his sickness because he really was living out what the Bible said about suffering, trusting, believing, and letting go and letting God handle what's happening in your life. Yes, Greg could and would carry on a conversation, and we all benefited from it. And when Greg talked, at least when he talked to me, he never could be still. He was always moving when he was talking, you know. And he just listened. I enjoyed it. Greg, hold on, buddy. You're wearing me out, buddy. I love Greg. I love my times of interacting with him. He would be. Greg loved his family and was very much concerned about their well-being. He was more concerned about you than he was himself. Greg made sure that his son Mike was up for work every morning. He would do whatever he had to do in order to get him up and on his way to work. Mike, there's no way to measure how many times your daddy kept you from being fired. Without That's right. And even when Greg could not communicate verbally, he still found ways to get you up. Greg was still raising Mike and trying to instill in him values of life that had been handed down to him as well. Mike, thank you for all you've done to make sure your daddy could stay at home and not in the nursing home that he feared that he might wind up. Greg loved his grandchildren and was concerned about them also. Gabby and Take therefore no thought